thank all of you for being here this evening, for taking an interest in Fred Rogers' life and work and his values, which carry on even 16 years after he died. And I want to thank Jeff for the effort that he has put in putting this three-day program together. Some of you may have been here over the last couple of nights, and it's really a wonderful tribute to Fred Rogers, but also a wonderful exercise, I think, for this community in thinking about what Rogers stood for. Now, I'm assuming that a lot of you who are here tonight know a lot about Fred Rogers. You may have watched Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Your children may have watched Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Maybe you watched it together. I'm sure a number of you have seen the wonderful documentary that Laurie referred to, and a few of you have read the book. So because I'm assuming that you know a fair amount about Fred Rogers already, I'm not going to give you sort of a basic, fundamental boilerplate recitation of his life. I want to do something a little bit different than that. I want to take two pivotal events from his life and work and focus on those. So I'm going to take these two very important moments, and in each case, what I'll do is I'll read you a short passage from the book, then we're going to show a video clip of the same one of these events, and then I'll tell you the backstory of what happened, why it happened, how it took place exactly the way it did, and what it means in terms of Rogers' values, Rogers' focus, and his work. So what I want to do is I want to start with a very famous episode that comes early on, 49 years ago, right after Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood went on national public television in 1968. And the very next year, Fred Rogers testified before Congress. Some of you may have seen the old grainy film clips from that testimony. And he was testifying on behalf of an allocation of money for the public broadcasting system. Back then, there were educational television stations. I think the very first one in the country was here at the University of Iowa. And there were educational television stations in cities around the country, at universities around the country, but there was no educational system. And there were a group of civic leaders and broadcast leaders who wanted to create PBS, the public broadcasting system. And they wanted to get the money to do it. They had lobbyists that worked for them in Washington. They did their work, and they had a $20 million appropriation that was going to go into the budget to start PBS. And they learned through their lobbyists that that allocation of money was at risk. Richard Nixon had just become president of the United States, and he wanted to cut the budget in a variety of ways because he was desperate to find the funding for the Vietnam War. There was not a special budget for the Vietnam War. It was just in the operating budget. So he wanted to cut the $20 million, and he was a Republican, of course, but there was a Democratic senator named John Pastore from Rhode Island who was close to Nixon, who chaired the Communications Committee for this appropriation. And Nixon had talked to Pastore about the importance of cutting that money to make it available for the war effort. And this group of executives knew they had to do something about that, so they made a plan to do it. And I'll read you a little bit of a passage, show you a clip of Rogers testifying, and then I'll tell you why it happened the way it happened. The lighting is so good here, I don't even need my glasses. That's fantastic. The hearing took place on May 1, 1969. More than four decades later, the exchange between Pastore and Rogers still can be seen online. The chairman of the Senate Subcommittee on Communications curtly commands his witness to begin. Okay, Rogers, you got the floor. In his disarming, guileless way, Rogers immediately alters the tone of the proceeding. With his first words delivered in the same measured cadence he uses in the neighborhood, he slows listeners down to his own very deliberate pace. He starts by telling Pastore that he won't read his prepared remarks, as they would take 10 minutes. Pastore draws laughter with a condescending riposte. Would it make you happy if you read it? But in his soft, slightly nasal Western Pennsylvania twang, Fred Rogers replies that he'll be glad to just talk about the work. Perhaps the only person unhappy with his decision was Elaine Lynch, his secretary back in Pittsburgh, who had been asked to type up Rogers' remarks from a longhand version on a yellow legal pad. She had dutifully created manuscripts for Rogers to read and share with those at the hearing. "I worked so hard in typing that speech," she recalled later, "and then he didn't read it. I was so disappointed." Rogers did intend to read the text, but his extraordinary situational sense told him it would be better to be direct and personal with the very brusque Pastore. Continuing to speak slowly and quietly, Rogers became passionate as he described his work. "One of the first things that a child learns in a healthy family is trust. And I trust what you have said, that you'll read this. It's very important to me. I care deeply about children." Let's see a 2-minute clip now from that hearing and Fred Rogers' testimony, which, as I said, has become famous since. So a couple of things happened as a result of that. First of all, at the end of the hearing, Pastore turns to Rogers and says, "Okay, Rogers, looks like you got your $20 million. The appropriation flowed through, it got PBS started, and it was a great success." Another thing that happened coming out of that is this video clip and other clips like it have been taught now for 50 years in business schools, in marketing classes, all around the country as an example of extraordinarily effective marketing. And the reason is authenticity. If you're real and you're genuine and you're authentic in what you're saying and what you're presenting to people, it carries the day. And Rogers' testimony is still taught in business schools around the country. But what's really interesting is, how did it come to be that it was Fred Rogers, a children's television personality, that would be testifying before Congress? With all these executives from educational television stations around the country, why wasn't an array of these executives? And the answer to that is in the person of a guy named Hartford Gunn, who was the president of WGBH in Boston. And he was a leader of this group of executives that wanted to start public television. And he later became the first president of PBS. Hartford Gunn was had been running nonprofit television and communications programs and nonprofits for about 12 or 15 years. But before that, he had been a businessman. He was a graduate of Harvard Business School. He was a savvy strategist. And when he pulled together the executives in Boston to talk about the hearing that was going to take place in Washington and what they needed to accomplish, what they needed to do, he said to them that he wanted to bring in Fred Rogers, who had been, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood had been less than a year on national television. Rogers wasn't that well known, and he was known principally as a performer for children. And all the other executives really bridled. They were pissed off at Hartford Gunn, and they said, you know, that's crazy, that's ridiculous. We've got to go down and convince Congress to put the money forward. We can't have a children's television star doing it. But Gunn knew what he was talking about, because several years earlier at WGBH, an earlier version of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood had been shown, as Fred just referred in that clip, on the Eastern Educational Network. So it was shown in Boston. And several years earlier, the station had brought in Fred Rogers to meet with parents and children. And they had planned for about 500, a group of about 500, which was a pretty big number for that station. And between 5 and 10,000 children and parents showed up for the event. They were lined up outside the station all the way down around Soldiers Field, where Harvard played football. And this huge crowd was there for hours. And Fred Rogers took the time to talk to every kid and talk to every parent, and Hartford Gunn was watching him. And what he saw was this remarkably genuine, caring person who connected in a very visceral way with people. And Gunn knew that he had two audiences that he had to affect for this appropriation: the senators, who were going to be there listening in at the hearing, and then later, he knew it was going to be videoed, he knew it was going to be shown on the news, he knew people were going to see it, and he wanted the public to be persuaded of the importance of the mission of public television. So Gunn had an awareness of the power of Fred Rogers as a presenter, and he convinced all these stiffs in suits to let him bring Fred Rogers in and take the lead on the testimony. The other thing that came out of this particular event that is so interesting is that Fred Rogers then became, for the rest of his life, and even today through video, a leading spokesman for educational television and for quality television. For years after that, he would appear at conferences. He testified again before Congress. He chaired a commission on public television several years later. And he became the leading spokesman for the idea that television could be high quality, could be educational, and could be important. Now, you have to remember that in the 1970s and the 1980s, and a lot of you do remember this, television was mostly crap. It wasn't very good. It was mostly about selling advertising for cereal and other products. And it wasn't really until almost the end of Fred Rogers' life when cable television began to create programming that rivals movies and rivals the best documentaries that television came into its own. And for a lot of the time that Rogers spent as a leading spokesman for educational television and for quality television, he was bitterly disappointed that television was so disappointing. He kept that to himself in terms of his public pronouncements, but he told his friends and his associates, and he told his wife, Joanne Rogers, about how disappointed he was. In fact, a few years before he retired in 2001 and stopped making Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, I think it was 1 year before, he shared with Joanne that he felt like a failure. He felt that he'd been trying to make really high-quality educational television for decades, and he'd been trying to be an effective spokesperson for that for decades, and television really hadn't moved that much. And he really sort of had a crisis of confidence. And he talked for a long time to Joanne. He talked to his great friend, Chancellor Douglas Nowicki from St. Vincent College, where the Fred Rogers Center is located now. And he prayed a lot, and he thought a lot, and he finally came to the conclusion that he had done his best. But he was disappointed that television really didn't rise to his expectations the way in the last 10, 12, 14 years, it really seems to have done. He cared about that in part because he cared about children, and he cared about education, and he cared about this tool that he thought could be an excellent vehicle for the education of children. But he also cared about it because he was fascinated by the technology of his time. Remember that when Fred Rogers went into television around 1950, television was every bit as astonishing a new communications technology as all social media and the internet and all the applications on the web are to us today. And it was Fred Rogers, really arguably the first person in the country involved in television, who recognized its educational potential. And he went on in the 1950s to study at the Office of Child Development at the University of Pittsburgh for many years. And he did so because he wanted to get the academic background. He wanted to get the knowledge and the understanding of child development, what was happening for children, to be able to make really wonderful children's television. And back then, the University of Pittsburgh was really the top center in the United States in early childhood development. You have to remember, if you said early childhood education to somebody back in 1955, they thought you meant kindergarten. There wasn't any early childhood education earlier than kindergarten. But Pitt, University of Pittsburgh then, was developing the thinking about child development and media and learning that was really transformative. Some of the best minds in the country were there. Dr. Benjamin Spock, the famous baby doctor, was at Pitt teaching then. Dr. Margaret McFarlane was the head of the department, a famous child development expert. Barry Brazelton, the doctor who was on public television for about 15 years, teaching about children, was at Pitt back then. Eric Erickson, the philosopher and expert on child development that started the Erickson Institute in Chicago that still exists today, was at Pitt back then. So Fred Rogers got dropped into this extraordinary petri dish of experimentation and thinking about child development just at the time that he needed that to make his programming as excellent as it was. And it really did become extraordinarily excellent. Nothing except Sesame Street has really ever rivaled it in terms of its instructional value. Now, what Rogers did for all those experts at Pitt in return was he brought the message to a mass audience in America about how important early childhood development is. That in the first few years of life, not just the cognitive learning, but the social and emotional development, the development of the brain, the physiology of the brain, is all taking place at a way that's far more important in terms of learning than ever again in our lives. And so America today understands that early childhood education is critically important. But Fred Rogers is really the person who brought that message to a mass audience. And he brought the excellence of his program as proof of the value of it. So now what I want to do is shift gears a little bit. And I want to tell another story later, about 12 years later than the Pastore hearing. And this has to do with another famous moment in Fred Rogers' life and work, another famous clip that probably a lot of you have seen, which is the interview Fred Rogers does with the little boy in the wheelchair, and then they sing together, which was a program that was made in 1981. And what happened then was that there had been a hiatus in Rogers' production of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood between 1975 and 1979, when he wasn't producing children's programming. Actually, he produced a fair amount of grown-up television programming, mostly for PBS, but some for NBC also. Frankly, it wasn't very good, and it didn't do very well. But after about 4.5 years of that, he had decided that he wanted to come back to producing children's programming, and he and an associate of his named David Newell, who plays Mr. McFeely postman character on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, were traveling in Hawaii. Rogers was making a speech in Hawaii, and David Newell, they were in a taxi cab. David Newell was reading the newspaper, and he read about a little boy who had tied a towel around his neck to be Superman and jumped out of a second-story window and been terribly hurt. And Rogers just became furious, furious that the media had misled a little child. And one of the, you know, Rogers was a very sweet, kindly, thoughtful, caring man, but he had a temper. He did occasionally get very angry, and the thing that would get him more angry than anything else was when he thought little children, because of their naivete, had been misled. So he was very upset about this, and he and Newell, on that trip to Hawaii, began to plan a week-long series of programs on superheroes, to deconstruct superheroes and explain them to children. So he brought on the Incredible Hulk and had Lou Ferrigno take off the whole outfit, show the children what he was doing. And they did that with other superheroes. And what it led to was a commitment by Rogers, with help from Dr. Margaret McFarlane, the woman who's running the Center for Child Development at Pitt, to start doing a long series of week-long programming, 5 days in a row programming on a particular theme. So it was called the Theme Week Series. And what Rogers and McFarlane decided to do was they wanted to take on the toughest subjects in the world, not just the toughest subjects for kids, but the toughest subjects anybody could imagine. They did a week-long series on violence. They did a week-long series on war. They did a week-long series on divorce, which is the most terrifying, or one of the most terrifying things that can happen to a little kid. They did a week-long series on loss and the idea that you can get lost. Remember the water going down the drain and Fred Rogers explaining to children they can't go down the drain? That was part of that week-long series on loss. So, in part of the week-long series on divorce that they did, Rogers wanted to show that things get broken, including marriages get broken. They can get fixed, they can get put back together, or they can get accommodated. Something else can happen that can make it okay for children. And he decided early on that he wanted to bring on a child in a wheelchair to show that somehow something had happened to that child, that had broken that child, but that accommodations had been made, and the wheelchair and other things helped the child survive the experience, find the resilience to come through it. So that's what led to this particular clip that you're going to see in 1 second after I read you this quick passage about Fred Rogers' interview with the little boy whose name was Jeff Erlanger. At that point, Fred said to him, "Jeff, I'm just going to ask you some questions, and then we'll sing a song together." He did say, "Remember, we're talking to very young children, so don't use any words that are too big." Jeff Erlanger didn't quite heed Mr. Rogers' words. In one of the neighborhood's most memorable broadcasts, Rogers asked Jeff straightforwardly about the mechanics of his wheelchair and how he wound up in it. The young boy explains his medical condition resulting from a spinal tumor in sophisticated detail, including even his urinary functions. Mr. Rogers listens intently and says simply, "Your parents must be very proud of you." This was the zen of Fred Rogers' radical acceptance. There was no topic he wouldn't address on air, no matter how difficult. "We don't fudge things," he said once when asked about the source of his show's popularity. "People long to be in touch with honesty." Producer Margie Whitmer recalls Jeff Erlanger's appearance on The Neighborhood. "It was one of the most stunning moments. Here's this child who has multiple disabilities, and Fred said, 'Talk to me about that wheelchair. Talk to me about what's wrong with you.' And this extraordinary kid talked about it in a matter-of-fact way. Fred presented it to the kids watching the show as, 'This is just the way he is.' Jeff's parents felt completely comfortable allowing their son to speak this way on television because, as Howard Erlanger explained, in our own way, we felt totally analogous to how the kids felt, that Fred Rogers was part of our family, that he was just a regular person." Let's take 2 minutes and watch Fred Rogers with Jeff Erlanger. And a lot of you may remember that then, together, they sing the song, "It's You I Like." And Rogers sings to him, it's you I like. It's not your wheelchair, that's just beside you," which is a variation of the lyrics to that song. Now, what's interesting about how Fred Rogers showed up with this particular young boy is that it was a complete surprise to his staff. And it's a good illustration of what a very focused, very deliberate and relentless driver of excellence Fred Rogers was. He could be stubborn as a mule, and he was. His staff loved working with him, but they knew that he always had a vision for what he wanted to accomplish, and he was extraordinarily stubborn about that. So he came to a couple of the producers and said that he wanted to get a young boy in a wheelchair to illustrate what the wheelchair could do to repair the situation for the young boy. And they said, well, that's great. We know there's a bunch of kids here in Pittsburgh who are in wheelchairs. We can get one easily right away and bring him over. And he said, no, that's not what I want. I know exactly who I want. I want this boy that I met when I was in Milwaukee last year named Jeff. And I want to go get him. And his staff said, we don't have to go to Milwaukee and fly in a kid and his wheelchair and his family. We can just do somebody here. Rogers said, no, I want this boy. I talked to him. I know he'll be perfect. And I know he'll do just what we need to get the message across. So they were finally persuaded, and they started looking for Jeff Erlanger. The problem was Fred Rogers remembered his name as Jeff Erlinger, not Erlanger, from Milwaukee, where Fred had met him when Fred had been gone to a speaking occasion, and Jeff's parents brought Jeff in to meet Fred and talk to him. But the Erlangers were from Madison, Wisconsin. So the staff couldn't find him, and they tried and tried, and Rogers kept insisting. And finally, one of the producers said, you're being so stubborn about this. What you're telling us is, if we can't find Jeff, you won't even do this episode? And he said, that's right. It's off. We're not going to do it. We might not even do the whole week. He could be a mule. He could be so stubborn. And so they called it off. And then about 4 or 5 weeks later, a woman named Hedda Sherapin, who had worked with Fred from 1967, I think, and did a lot of the letters. She did the mail that came in, and she would craft answers to Fred Rogers, made sure that everybody who wrote him a letter got an answer. Everybody, every child, every parent got an answer. And he went over everyone personally to make sure that it was right. But he couldn't write them all, and so Hedda put them together. She got a letter from Jeff Erlanger's sister, and she put the two and two together because the sister mentioned her brother Jeff in the letter. And she brought it to Fred, and she said, is this the boy you're talking about? Yes, he said, that's the one. So we're going to fly him and his parents and his sister and his wheelchair in from Madison, Wisconsin. So the staff finally agreed to do that, and they made the arrangements to bring him in. And then Jeff Erlanger's parents began to get concerned about exactly what is it they were going to encounter, what was going to happen, what would their son have to do appearing on television, which he'd never done before. And they started asking questions of the staff. And the staff were getting a little bit concerned because a fair amount of what went on in the neighborhood was scripted. Rogers had precise ideas about what he wanted to say, what he wanted to communicate, and a lot of times it would be fairly well scripted. But other times, there wasn't a script. And for Fred, the difference was when he wanted to capture a special moment that was completely spontaneous and authentic, he wouldn't script it. So he told his staff, there's no script for this. He said, we're just gonna talk for a little bit. That's all that's gonna happen. The parents were increasingly anxious. The staff was anxious. They kept pressing Rogers for details, and he wouldn't. Jeff Erlanger, by the way, was not anxious. He wasn't worried a bit about it. And he wouldn't give them any details. So what you saw there is based on absolutely nothing except about 40 minutes before they go on, Jeff Erlanger comes into the station, they go on the set, and they have that conversation. And of course, what Fred Rogers understood was that, particularly for little children, something that is contrived, that has been fashioned, that is made up, is not convincing. Children can spot phoniness faster than anything in the world, and they don't buy it if it's contrived. And so Rogers, whatever happened in that episode, Rogers wanted it to be absolutely spontaneous and authentic, and it's become, you know, one of the two most famous clips from Fred Rogers' entire work. What it illustrates to me is not just how stubborn Fred Rogers was, but what a perfectionist he was. And you have to realize that back in the 1950s, when he went into public television in Pittsburgh at WQED, and he started making, started making a children's program called The Children's Corner, which was a precursor to The Neighborhood. It was done on a shoestring. They had almost no budget for it. It was just him and a woman who had been a secretary at the station named Josie Carey, who volunteered for it. They had so little budget that they would go to the library and get film, and they would just show the film. And as often as not, the film would break, and so they'd have to jump up and sing a song, or that's where the puppets came in first, because he had to have the puppets to fill some time. And Rogers was, he had a great time with that experience, and he learned a lot from it, but he was very, very frustrated by it, because he knew it was entertaining television, but it was not excellent, high-end educational television. And that was what he was committed to. It's why he did the studies that he did at Pitt, that he did at the same time he was getting his, that he was going to the seminary and becoming a Presbyterian minister. And his stubbornness was born of the fact that he believed fervently that things had to be perfect for children, that children were at such a very special time in the early learning years of their lives, that whatever was created for them really had to be perfect. And that came out of Fred's own childhood, which was a very difficult, lonely, shy childhood in Latrobe, Pennsylvania. His parents were wonderful. They loved him. They took care of him. But they were overly protective, and he was a very lonely little boy. And he really had a long, difficult struggle. And it wasn't until he was about 10 or 11 years old that he sort of came out of that and began to fashion what he would be in high school and then later as an adult. He had a fabulously successful high school career. He was the president of the student body. He was a national merit scholar. He was the editor of the yearbook. He was in the theatrical productions because he had come through this difficult childhood and he had fashioned an approach to his life that would work for him. That's what he wanted to give to other children. And he wanted to give it to them in a way that was very powerful and very strong and met the highest standards of excellence. And that's why he could be such a very, very stubborn person. I think what I want to do now is take a break from my presentation, bring my great friend Saleem Ghubril up here. Saleem and I have worked on all sorts of things together in Pittsburgh, so we know each other well, and have Saleem talk to you a little bit and show you part of the eulogy from the wonderful service back when Fred Rogers died. And then we'll talk some more, and we'll hear from you in a little bit. Thank you very much.
And Max and I work together to this day. As you were told earlier, he is the president and CEO of the Pittsburgh Foundation, and I lead an initiative in Pittsburgh called the Pittsburgh Promise, which lives at the Pittsburgh Foundation. So think of the Pittsburgh Foundation as the mothership and the Promise as one of its subsidiaries, and I'm privileged. So he is the Donald Trump of the Pittsburgh Foundation, and I am his Betsy DeVos. Peggy, Max's wife, is also here. Peggy, good to have you in Iowa City. So my family came to Iowa City in the mid-70s, 1976 to be exact, during the Civil War in Lebanon, and we came here kind of stunned by the impact of that catastrophic event on that little country. And this church, St. Andrew, was the church that welcomed us as its new neighbors and were to us the good neighbor for which we're very thankful. And to this day, I will never stop thinking about and appreciating the impact that this family had on my family. So Jeff's comments earlier, when he was introducing this thing, he told you about the fact that I started the Pittsburgh Project that works with kids in the city of Pittsburgh, and then later the Pittsburgh Promise. So we started the Pittsburgh Project in 1985. And we started involving kids in volunteer service, fixing houses for seniors, which the Pittsburgh Project still does. My daughter was born in 1984. The project was born in 1985. My son was born in 1986. And those are kind of like the three kids that my wife and I claim. About 3 or so years into the Pittsburgh Project's life, when my daughter was about 5 and my son was about 3, the weight of the work was getting kind of heavy on the family, and they were feeling, you know, the summers basically, their dad, I would disappear to run our summer program. And then one of the volunteers, a contractor in the city of Pittsburgh who was very involved as a volunteer with our organization, his name is John Lynch, J.T. Lynch. He said to me, okay, your kids and your wife need something special. How about if I arrange for you to take them to meet Mr. Rogers at one of the tapings? In Max's earlier comments, when he was telling the and he said that Elaine Lynch had typed up this full manuscript and she was mad that Fred wasn't reading it. So J.T. Lynch, who was one of our volunteers, is Elaine's ex-husband. So he said, listen, my ex-wife is Fred's secretary. I know they're taping this week. She and I are still friends. I can ask her to arrange to see if you could bring your kids and take them down to meet Fred on set, which, of course, was like incredible. So that's exactly what happened, and that's how we met Fred. And I will never forget kind of how he treated my 5-year-old and my 3-year-old. And he didn't treat them as, okay, you know, we're taping right now. This is big people's business. We're on set, we're working, and you're interrupting my flow. No, he stopped everything. And he kind of became a 90-degree right angle, eyeball to eyeball with my 2 small children, telling them how special they are and how wonderful it is to have them as his visitors on his set, and stopped the taping and walked them around and showed them the different things and the trolley and the hand puppets. And it was a very, very, very special moment. So that's how we met Fred. He and I are both Presbyterian ministers, and both of us are ordained in our denomination as, this is what our denomination calls us, specialized ministers. Neither of us served churches. His pulpit was children's television, and mine was the community, working with kids in a neighborhood. And our presbytery ordained both of us to do that specialized, that's what they called it, work. So we had that in common. He met my kids, but then that was really the end of it. It was just an event. It wasn't the beginning of a relationship. It was an event that took place. The president, series of events also emerged. The president of Family Communications, that was then the organization out of which the program was produced. The president of that organization is a man by the name of Bill Eisler, a good friend of Peggy's and Max's and mine. So the Pittsburgh Project at that same time bought an old vacant Catholic school building. It just so happened that back in the day when Bill Eisler was a school teacher, he taught in that school. And Bill heard that somebody had bought the school in which he taught, and he came to meet that somebody. And that was kind of like another event that took place. And he saw our work with kids, and he said, huh, Fred would love to see this. So he brought Fred. Now, the previous time we had met, I took my kids to visit Fred. Now Bill brought Fred to our center to see our work with kids in an urban neighborhood. And it was just a very special thing. Shortly thereafter, we were asked to for a program happening in the city of Pittsburgh to record children singing the neighborhood song. And then Fred came to the recording. He was with us at the studio with about 25 children singing his song, along with a few of our staff members and neighbors. So it was like an adult, combined adult children's choir, mostly children with a few adult lines. And he came and he attended that recording and then brought pizza and ice cream for the kids. And after the recording, spent 2 or 3 hours just learning something about each of them. I'm going to ask right now Jeff to play the audio recording of the song that our kids recorded of Fred's music. Gospel version.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Would you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood. A neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine?
Not Fred Rogers at the piano, jazz music, but it just kind of is a fun version that sounds like a gospel song and kids clapping their hands, and Fred loved it. And this was used for just a short stint as the background music for United Way commercial in Pittsburgh in the late 90s. Some of you may be familiar with the Catholic priest Henry Nouwen. Henry taught Father Nouwen, Dr. Nouwen, taught at a couple of Ivy League universities, psychologist, pastoral care professor, but also happens to be a Catholic priest. And a very impressive resume, a whole bunch of books to his credits. And then after a while, Henry felt like his success was destroying his spirit. And he decided to sign off. He just kind of quit academia, left the universities, left Yale, left Princeton, and then went and lived in Toronto with a group, in a house with a group of physically and or mentally challenged human beings, adults, and people who could not read his books were not impressed by his resume and just simply wanted his company and wanted to know that he would be back tomorrow after whatever he traveled to lecture somewhere to do. So I was introduced to Father Nouwen, and one book in particular that he wrote called In the Name of Jesus, which is a series of three talks that Henry gave at a conference that are about the subject of leadership. And the lectures are powerful and impactful and significant. But to me, the most significant thing was the prologue and the epilogue of the book, in which Henry Nouwen talks about Bill Van Buren, one of the men who lived in this community, who was physically healthy but had his mental challenges. And Henry took Bill Van Buren with him to Washington, D.C. to speak at this conference. So they were the three lectures that make up the three chapters of the book were given in D.C. at this conference, and Bill Van Buren was there with him. But the prologue and the epilogue talk about how Bill viewed we're doing this together. And it was so special and so powerful, and to this day, I find it so incredibly moving. And I thought, you know, Henry is another version of Fred Rogers. So I thought, you know, I would introduce Fred to Henry Nouwen by sending him a copy of the book and a handwritten note. And Fred very kindly wrote me back, and I have about a dozen handwritten notes from Fred that I will forever cherish. He sent me a note back thanking me for my thoughtfulness and kindness and what an important book this is. But then he also included a photograph of him at Henry Nouwen's funeral. So the two of them were good friends, and I thought I was doing Fred this great favor by introducing him to Henry Nouwen. And then he added at the end, and I'm so glad you gave me this book because I know somebody I would like to share this book with. Like, he couldn't have bought them a book, but he was so concerned about me not feeling badly about, oh man, this is embarrassing. And that is just so Fred. So when Fred died in 2003, shortly after his death, Bill Eisler, the president of his company, called me and he said, Fred planned his own memorial service. And he was friends with Yo-Yo Ma and with Yitzhak Perlman, and he'd invited both of them to play, and both of them were there to play. And Jeff Erlanger was no longer a little boy, but was a grown man in his wheelchair. He was also there as one of the speakers. But he, Fred, as he, you know, on his deathbed, on his notepad, writing his wishes for his funeral service, he said, homily, and he put my name next to it. And when Bill told me that, I said to him, I said, that is second only. I said, having my name written by Fred Rogers on his deathbed is second only to having my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, church language, for those of you who may not be familiar with that. So if you would not mind too terribly, I'm going to ask Jeff to play the video of that 3-minute homily at Fred's memorial.
A couple of years ago, Mr. and Mrs. Rogers stopped by the Pittsburgh Project to visit us and see one of the performances that our children in our program were putting on. Earlier that week, I informed the children that we were going to have very special guests, and of course, they were elated. The night of the show, Mr. and Mrs. Rogers came in their typical fashion, and without fanfare, they took their seats in the side bleachers and did not want to draw attention to themselves. Halfway through the production, one of the children who was trying so hard to spot Mr. Rogers in the audience but couldn't, in the middle of the performance, shouted, "Where you at, Mr. Rogers? Where you at?" "Where you at, Mr. Rogers?" Today, I have absolutely no question as to Mr. Rogers' whereabouts. He is in the heavenly neighborhood after which he modeled his television neighborhood. And he is with the architect of that neighborhood, the one who gave shape to Mr. Rogers' vision and fueled his passion. Author Max Lucado wrote about a season in his life when he was traveling a great deal. He didn't like to travel and be away from home and his family. He said his favorite leg of any flight was the last leg, the journey home. He would anticipate the wheels of the plane touching down, and he would have one hand on his briefcase and one hand on his seatbelt ready to bolt. And he would make it through the jetway and find a crowded room filled with people who weren't there to see him. But then he would hear the hand clapping of a child. He would follow that familiar sound until his eyes would land on a little girl standing on a chair, applauding the coming home of her daddy. And as soon as she knew that his eyes caught hers, she would jump off the chair and come running to him, and he would pick her up and hold her and love her and kiss her and tell her how special she is. On Thursday, February 27th, 2003, Mr. Rogers was on a plane going home. His trip was rich with great experiences, warm memories, and deeply, deeply, profoundly loved people. That day was the last leg of his flight home. He had one hand on his sweater and one hand on his seatbelt. And as soon as he heard the captain's bell, he unfastened his seatbelt and bolted through the jetway and into the crowded waiting area. There was his father, James, and his mother, Nancy, his grandfather and grandmother, Mr. and Mrs. Fred McFeely, and there were other family and friends and neighbors. And after a few moments of celebration, he heard the hand clapping of one. He followed the sound until his eyes caught the eyes of his God, who was standing on a chair clapping for him. God ran towards Fred, embraced him, loved him, kissed him, and told him how special he is. "Well done," he said. "Well done, my good and faithful servant. For I was lonely and you visited me. I was scared and you reassured me. I was feeling small and vulnerable and like I didn't matter, but you told me I was special. I was afraid of taking a bath, and you told me I could never go down the drain. I was frightened by the news about military planes and war, but you comforted me." And Mr. Rogers responded, "When, Lord? When?" And the Lord answered, "Fred, when you did it to any one of the least of these, my children, you did it to me. Come now to your new home, your eternal neighborhood."
I remember Fred getting on television at times that are scary times for anybody, but would be particularly scary for kids. I remember my kids sitting in front of the television during the first Gulf War in the early 90s, when Fred got on the air just to comfort children, because he knew with 24-hour news that kids were seeing scary things happening. And my kids were comforted by that. Today, you may know this, just a couple of hours ago, there was another shooting at a synagogue just outside of San Diego. Today, 6 months ago, was the shooting at the synagogue in our town in Pittsburgh, exactly 6 months ago today. A few weeks ago, a mosque in New Zealand. A couple of years back, a church in Charleston. I miss Fred Rogers, and we don't have another Fred-like personality today who is the chief and lead comforter in the lives of our kids and our communities. And that just happens to be at a time when that is more desperately needed than ever. I just kind of have this feeling that the baton has been passed on to us to play that role, to be those peacemakers and those comforters and those who make life easier and better and more fun and peaceful. And I hope that we are all found ready to pick up that baton. Max, would you mind joining me back up on stage while we take some questions?
So we are going to allow you to answer your questions, and both Saleem and Max are here ready to answer. I have to take a moment for a commercial interruption. and say that while this event is being offered at no charge for everyone here, it is not a free event. We are still collecting some of the funds to help pay for all of this in the weekend. And we want to say that every dollar that we make above those expenses, we are going to be donating to a organization I think Fred Rogers would very much approve of, the Neighborhood Centers of Johnson County. So you, as you walk out, you will see these very subtly colored buckets that will have the word donations next to. If you feel so moved, please help us support both the work that and the good message we've had today and the work of Neighborhood Centers of Johnson County. I luckily get the first chance for a question, and then I will come out to you, and please wait for the microphone to come to you. We're being recorded for City Channel 4. We are on Facebook Live right now, so smile as you answer the question. Ask the question. My question comes from my conversations that we had with the Kerry Johnsrud and Kevin Bales quartet last night. That jazz quartet has been working for years to try to put together the music of Fred Rogers, and it was before the documentary, it was before your biography had been published, and they found that Mr. Rogers largely had passed into the past. They still have a hard time booking a jazz club because even though they have very adult music, everyone just assumes that it's going to be a kids show, though when they play their music. Were you surprised over the last year and a half by what seems to have been a renaissance in interest in Fred Rogers? And I guess it's a question for both of you as well.
Actually, I don't think I was that surprised. I expected the 50th anniversary of the neighborhood to resonate in some way, but much more importantly, I thought and I think that Roger's message and the particular way that he was able to deliver his message, the values that he expressed, have been becoming increasingly important, not less important. And I think you see the response to that on the internet, on social media, whenever something happens. His name comes up, his sayings come up, the things that he wrote, the things that he expressed come up. And Saleem just referred to some of the more harsh, frightening things that have happened in recent years. But beyond those specific events, I think we live in a time for a wide variety of reasons, many of them not political, many of them sociological, when things seem very tense, very fast-paced, harsh, often frightening, disconcerting for a lot of people. And I think that Fred's values, which of course are his deeply held Christian values as a Presbyterian minister, but also very much the sort of universal human values of respect and compassion and kindness and integrity and understanding, those values mean more than ever right now. I think at a time that seems as intense as it does today, they're terribly important, and more people are turning to them.
I can't add much to that. I can't.
Is there a question or a comment right here?
Brilliant presentations and heartwarming. I found it ironic when you told the story about Fred's anger at the child who thought he really was Superman, and then to think back that the man who played Superman died as a paraplegic. But I find it even more ironic in the documentary that people were protesting about this man. Can you explain that?
Well, I certainly can't explain the protests. There were protests outside his memorial service where Saleem spoke, and Peggy and I were there. And I can't explain them, excuse me, in terms of the thinking of the people who were protesting, other than the fact that things seem so contentious today in the last 20, 25, 30 years, that sort of everything becomes a subject for protest. But I guess another part of it is the fact that people are sometimes frightened by as much goodness and kindness as somebody like Fred Rogers could show. It can be disconcerting when somebody in the face of harshness in the world can be that forgiving and thoughtful and kind. You know, we've all referenced the fact that Fred was a Presbyterian minister several times, but he was also a great student of all the world's philosophies and religions. He read about Catholic mysticism, Jainism, Buddhism, Lao Tzu, Confucius, the Muslim faith, Hinduism. And he read about all these things because he was interested to know that there is a common set of strong human values that sort of override everything else in terms of what we care about and how we live our lives. And I think some people protest that, find that disconcerting.
And the protesters who were at the memorial service that we had to walk through, now there weren't many of them. There were maybe a dozen, 15 of them who, thank you very much, who felt that, you know, if that's possible, Fred loved too much and he embraced too many and welcomed lots of folks that they thought should not be welcomed and should not be embraced and should not be loved, as though such a person exists. Such a person does not exist. But for this group of folks, now they are part of, I'm going to put this in quotes, part of a church, because I don't think it's a church, but anyway, they're part of a faith community that is quite exclusive and have very very rigid views about who's in and who's out. And they just thought that Fred just embraced all. What's the matter with this man? Now, what I thought was really significant is the memorial service was a long memorial service. I don't remember how long it was, but it was fairly long. And I wasn't sure whether anybody who had the microphone, because nobody was scripted, everybody could say and what they felt they wanted to say and felt called to say. And I just kind of wondered whether anybody would make mention of the 15 folks who were protesting outside, but not one did. Not one did, because that was such an aberration, that there are always folks who hate goodness and are appalled by too, what they would consider to be too reckless or too abandoned of a love. I mean, you know, that's what got Jesus crucified. You know, like too loving and too embracing and too welcoming, and made those who thought that there ought to be a rigid set of standards and rules mad. So it's not surprising when there's that kind of a reaction to that kind of grace. And that should cause us all the more to be all the more driven to demonstrate that and to be people of reckless, abandoned love and embrace. I know Fred would want that, and for me, even Jesus would want that.
As much as you have put your mind and your body and your soul into all of this that you've talked with us tonight, I'm sure you have spent a lot of time thinking, oh my God, where is someone like Fred now? I'm old enough, I'm really old, to have remembered a bit of what Winston Churchill was to England during the Second World War, what some of FDR's fireside chats meant to those of us in the United States. My God, if we ever needed anything, we need it now. Do you have anyone in mind who might at least have the potential or at least some, if any suggestions for that?
What's your name, sir?
It's all right. My wife will kill me when I get home anyway.
I like Saleem's answer earlier, which in a way he just gave again by asking you your name, which is, it's us. It has to be us. And I think one of the interesting things that's happening today culturally around the United States is, after a period of time when so much attention has gone to Washington, D.C., and the contention and the political struggles in Washington, D.C., I feel the attention kind of coming back to Pittsburgh, coming back to Iowa, coming back to Colorado, and that people are thinking about what's right and what's wrong about our society today, what needs to be done, where are they going to find it, where are they going to find the strength, where are they going to find the lessons, and coming back home to try to find those. I believe that's happening, and I hope it's happening.
Given that answer, I'm curious as to the upcoming election and the slate of candidates for the Democratic Party in terms of the value of electability, quote unquote, which seems to be wholly against everything that Fred Rogers stood for in terms of authenticity. And I'm curious as to what you think that people who are not running for office can do in order to promote the value of authenticity instead of the value of electability when it comes to the upcoming election.
Max?
Please, Saleem, I think it's your turn.
So the question is, what can people do, regular, ordinary us, all of us, to promote the values of authenticity over the values of electability? Implied in that question, I think, is that what happens in our neighborhoods maybe is more important than who lives on 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. And then our values ought not be shaped by that address. Our values ought to be what shape that address. And it's our day in and day out living. People like Fred and other, some of you and many great leaders, and some were mentioned in your comments, sir, Churchill, and who else did you mention?
FDR.
FDR, thank you. Max mentioned a list of philosophic and religious leaders. I mentioned Jesus by name. Those that we look up to the most were not ones who exerted power, but they were ones who modeled sacrificial living, generous living, grace-filled, gracious living. I would elevate those values.
I think in offering, in offering a little bit of an answer, Daniel, I would come back to Fred's own personal emphasis on individual relationships. Sure. People think that children and education and television and all the programming that he developed, the songs that he created, the puppet characters that he created, were the most important things to Fred Rogers in his life, and they were not. The most important thing to Fred Rogers in his life was that individual relationship that he would have with people that he knew, people he worked with, and people that he didn't know, that he would just meet. That was the single most important thing to Fred Rogers. That's what he believed was the most important thing he would do every day. He was a guy who woke up almost every morning at 5 a.m. To read the Bible and pray. But what's interesting is what he was praying for when he prayed. He didn't pray for success in his program. He didn't pray for the production to go better, for the neighborhood to be better, for more children to be reached. He prayed about the coming day. He almost envisioned the day the way an athlete envisions a contest. What's going to happen? And what Fred did, literally, was he thought about, who am I going to see today? At work, at WQED, at lunch, in the afternoon, later, at the athletic club, when I go swimming. Who am I going to see, and how can I be as thoughtful and kind and considerate with that person today? That's what he really cared about.
The proud mother of my daughter works for one of the neighborhood groups who's going to be receiving the extra money. So I, through my career as a nurse and a mom, I certainly hope I did some of Fred Rogers showing kindness and caring. And when I see my daughter interact with these children who come from, their parents have come from very unfortunate, non-loving families. When I see her provide for them, I love you, I care about you, and you are important to me, makes me very proud. Maybe my patient will tell you I was a nice nurse, I'm not sure. But to me, Fred Rogers, there will never be a Fred Rogers. But how he influences the kindness of each of us is what we can offer to people of the world.
Thank you so much for sharing that.
I am curious about the family of Fred Rogers. We had, what it was like to be Mrs. Fred Rogers. And you touched on it in the book, what it's like to be, you know, I think both sons said, you know, because he was as close to being a saint. Several of my Presbyterian colleagues and I have joked that he is the Presbyterian saints. Presbyterians don't have saints, but he's right. He's as close as you can come to being a saint. So what's it like to be that close to him? What did you find out that maybe didn't make the book?
Well, for his two little boys, who are grown men, almost my age now, John and Jim, they found him when they were very young to be really, really extraordinarily caring and thoughtful as a parent. He paid a lot of attention to them. He came home every day. Even when they were going to be filming into the evening, he would come home. And Jim reported that sometimes he would be there in his pancake makeup. He wouldn't even have time to take his makeup, but he made sure he was there every afternoon to talk to them. When they got older, when they became teenagers, it didn't work so well. It was a lot harder. He didn't have the same natural instinct for dealing with teenagers, and they had struggles. The two boys acted out, they were bad. The most famous moment is when Joanne Rogers discovered the grow light for their marijuana crop in the basement of the house, and Fred had to make them take it out and destroy it in the backyard. But to this day, as difficult it is to be the child of a famous parent, they really revere how much he meant to them. For Joanne, it was a little bit different. Joanne got frustrated sometimes because Fred could be self-absorbed. Fred was very focused on being a good person, as I described a minute ago. It mattered a lot to him. He was focused on his work. He spent a lot of time thinking about the scripts that he was going to write, the songs that he was going to write. And so he wasn't always available to Joanne, and he could be self-absorbed. And she, I had, I think, seven wonderful long interviews with her, and she was very honest and shared that. She loved him, she misses him terribly, but there were some frustrations. And I think of Fred as a saint too, whatever a saint is, but he wasn't perfect. And he didn't think he was perfect.
All saints have feet of clay. I've only met his boys very briefly. It was actually at the memorial service, so I don't have a relationship with him, but I do with Joanne, and she's an awful lot of fun. She is 92 years old, And she is a classically trained concert pianist who's absolutely incredible. Now, her fingers aren't quite as limber on the keys as they once were, but for years, every December, Joanne would come to our center on the north side where we threw a Christmas party, and she would play the piano. The night would end with Joanne playing the piano and leading the 400, 500 guests who were there and singing Christmas carols. It was like this most incredible time with Grandma at the piano singing carols with Joanne Rogers. Just a lovely, lovely person. He was lucky to have her.
There is a country western song called Who's Gonna Fill Their Shoes? And you've kind of been already asked that question. I'm not gonna ask it, but part of that song goes through a number of country western artists. And I guess my question is about his relationships, thoughts about Captain Kangaroo, Barney, Lamb Chop. You pick whatever ones you want to.
He was particularly, excuse me again, he was particularly friends with Bob Keeshan, Captain Kangaroo. And every day on Keeshan's birthday, Fred would call him up. Excuse me, every year on Keeshan's birthday, Fred would call him up and wish him a happy birthday. And they talked with some frequency. The programs were very different. Captain Kangaroo was amusement, not education so much. But he did have other friends, and he had a cordial and friendly relationship with a number of the people from the Sesame Street cast, and with Joan Ganz Cooney, who was the founder of Sesame Street. So he had a lot of those friendships in the business. But he wasn't somebody who found celebrity attractive for himself or for anybody else. So he didn't seek it out. And he didn't often make a big deal of those friendships.
Thank you for not going to ground there, Jeff. Yeah. Speaking of friendships, tell us a little bit about his friends outside of his professional business relationships.
Could I get that question again?
Sure. Speaking about friendships, what about some of his friends that he had that were not professionally related, business related to him?
Do you want to take a crack at it? Or?
You know, he was a Pittsburgher, so lots of folks in Pittsburgh felt that he was their friend. He lived he once had a very nice house, but lived for the majority of his life in a fairly humble place, accessible. He, you know, he swam at this place where other people swam and felt like they could get close to him. They saw him without a shirt on. That's how close they got to him. Bill Eisler, who is the president of his company, though it was a business relationship, but Bill was like another son to him, very close and very loving towards him. His staff would tell you that they felt that way. In addition to being a hard-nosed boss. Max, you may have more insight on this.
Well, Fred was a member of the 6th Presbyterian Church in Squirrel Hill, the neighborhood, a few blocks from the Tree of Life synagogue where the shooting took place. And it's a big congregation, a very progressive congregation in the middle of the city, in a city neighborhood. And he had a lot of friends at that church. And so almost every Sunday, two or three or four people would come back to have lunch with Fred and Joanne, and when they were little, the boys, from that church service. So I would say most of his friendships that didn't relate to WQED or Mr. Rogers' neighborhood were at the 6th Presbyterian Church.
Max, earlier you talked about how the quality of TV when Mr. Rogers started was quite disappointing to him. But you made a comment that you thought that that there were changes going on, that you felt that TV was becoming better today. I'd like you to elaborate on that because I'm not sure I see that.
Well, I think from Fred's perspective, he thought he saw it getting better toward the end of his life. From my perspective, I see it getting better and worse. I see that the extraordinary array of programming we get from cable television, some of it is shockingly horrible. My poor wife, Peggy, who likes to watch a lot of television series with me, has to put up with my just walking out of the room sometimes because I can't stand the astonishing levels of violence, the astonishing things that people do to each other. So I think it's getting worse on some levels, but in a lot of other levels, much, much better. There's so many cable television dramas today that explore relationships and families and communities and issues in a way that to me is equal to some of the best movies. And I think that's kind of a remarkable change and really surprising to me, given that it's taken place at exactly the time when the internet and social media developed a whole array of other kind of content approaches. So I'm not sure where it's all headed. Sometimes it's dizzying and overwhelming, but a lot of it's very high quality, I think.
So our time is coming to a close, but Max, you will be willing to stay in the back and sign books and talk to people?
Indeed I will.
All right. And we are going to give you guys just one chance, last chance, to wrap up all of this experience. We would like your final thoughts on what you think, what message, what advice you have for us to actually become, to live up, to be the engaged, compassionate, aware neighbors that for every show Fred Rogers told us that we were. And we'll start with Saleem and then give Max the last word.
Fred, almost always, when he came into a public space, almost always had a small pocket camera in his the inside coat pocket of his. And the reason he did that was before cell phones and cell phone cameras. He always had a little Instamatic in his coat pocket. Because he knew that everywhere he went, somebody would say to him, "Can I take a picture of you or with you?" And he would always say yes, but then he would respond by saying, "Now may I take a picture of you?" And he wanted to communicate something with that. He wanted to communicate the significance of every person. So you recognize me. You know, my kids, when they were 3 and 5, and then he was hunched down and looking at them, they just, like this, how did he come out of the that little box that they watched him on, You know, they were just kind of blown away, and they recognized him as this somebody very special and very significant, but he turns the table on everybody, recognizing the specialness and significance that exists in each person. That is, I think, something that we can nurture. We can nurture in terms of our viewing every other human without qualification, without adding anything else to that, every other human as spectacularly special and profoundly significant. Not that we should go through life snapping pictures of people who don't want their pictures taken, but there's something powerful about even those viewing, even those we disagree with, and we have maybe little to nothing in common with, recognizing that we do share our common humanity, that inside every one of us is this, the breath of life that was breathed into the nostrils of Adam, however, when, and is still being breathed through the nostrils of Adams and Eves everywhere. I think that would be something that I would like to nurture.
I only met Fred twice. The second time I was just walking down the street and saw him and we just briefly said hello. The first time I was running a foundation that Laurie referred to, the Heinz Endowment, which funded Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood and funded the programming that Family Communications did. And Bill Eisler, who Saleem just mentioned, asked me to come in to Fred's office and meet with him. And so I went to his office and we talked for about an hour and 20 minutes. And I thought, because I ran a foundation and he was putting together this program, we would be talking about his program. What were his plans for the neighborhood? What was he going to be doing? What was he going to develop? How much was it going to cost? How much money did they need? And for an hour and 20 minutes, we never said one word about Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. We never talked at all about television. We didn't talk about educational television for children. We didn't talk about money. He never said a word about any of that. We talked about each other. He asked me lots and lots of questions about me, and I asked him about him. It turned out our families share an experience on a small island off Massachusetts where his family had a little house and my family has a little house at the other end of the island. We didn't even know that. So we talked about his mother, and that's all the conversation was about. That's what he cared about. He cared about connecting with people, and I think that's what we need to do, as Saleem said, to honor Fred's memory and his legacy. I think that's the best way to do it. A lot of times, Jeff, when I'm speaking, people will say, can you sum up in a couple of words what Fred's message is? I mean, after all, it's America. We like sound bites. What's the sound bite for Fred Rogers? And hopefully in a respectful way for Fred, yes, I can. I think there's a simple way of trying to encompass at least the heart of what his message was. And it's this simple. Slow down. Be kind. Slow down. Be kind. And they're connected. They were connected for Fred. Fred didn't think you could be the sort of person you needed to be unless you slowed down. And everybody reported the same experience with him of things calming down and slowing down. And it's a good way, particularly in this frantic world, to honor him, I think. Thank you.